part, Myers. Look at mommy. Look at mommy. Look at mommy. Look at me.
Marco! Marco!
Oh.
flying soldier.
In the back. Yeah, I'm listening to your relatives right now. Listen to your relatives. Go ahead. Now I'm talking to look, you see your
Hey, land.
Y'all seen daddy?
left and six on the right.
Okay, we'll do the six on the right.
Yes, just like the mama.
Have a great day, folks.
Take the right hand side of 5X. And then go to the right. And then how many of you guys? You're going to take the left side of 5A.
Watch your closing doors, please. And good afternoon, Brooks of Explorers, and welcome aboard the Wild Asia Monorail. My name is Eugene. I'll be your guide and driver. Now, folks, this is very important for your safety. Please remain seated at all times with your hands and feet inside the car. And if you need to contact me at any time, there's an intercom system right by the door. Give us a few seconds, folks. And we are on our way. Here at the Bronx Zoo, the headquarters of the Wildlife Conservation Society, we're working to save wildlife and wild places around the world. We have scientists, legal guards working in the field, and zookeepers working right here at home to protect the wide range of life. Now I'm going to point out the animals as we approach them, but I'm going to need your help. Scientists and zookeepers need good observation skills to learn about animal behavior and to ensure their health. Let me know what you see and please share with the other guests. And we have now traveled over 7,000 miles and arrived in Asia. Be on the lookout for animals. Yes, that was quick. Now, Asia is the continent known for its vast deer population and its deer diversity. Now, as the train comes around, if you can, look back to the left. You see those spotted deer back there? And for those back to the right, those two deer known as the axis deer. Now, they're native to India and Sri Lanka, and the Bronx Zoo has shown those particular deer here since 1899, when the zoo first opened 123 years ago. Now, if you look up to the right, see those tan and white feathered animals, they are known as the black buck antelope. Now, they're classified as sexually dimorphic, only meaning that the males and the females look different from one another, even though they are the same species. Now, those are females. They have that tan coat white belly with no horns, and the males will have that chocolate coat white belly with those horns. Now, as you come up, folks, I want you to start looking to the right. You're about to see our new addition here at the Bronx Zoo. They are known as the Bactrian deer. Again, look to the right. They are brand new, all the way from Central Asia. We got them last year. Now, one of our WCS researchers in Afghanistan located some after not being seen for nearly 40 years. These are the Bactrian deer that we have right here at the Bronx Zoo. And these small bills that we're passing here on the right represent a very interesting WCS conservation story. That's extinct no longer exists. Now the next animal is on the verge of extinction. In fact, the Mongolian wild horse, or the Shabowski's horse, was extinct in nature. And they can only be found in zoos. But recently, there have been some reintroductions of the Mongolian wild horses in areas of Mongolia and China from our North America and Asian zoos. And as the train rounds this corner, we're coming into the lower part of our meadow. If you look down to the bottom right, you're now looking at the beautiful Mongolian wild horses. These are beautiful animals. The Mongolian wild horses. Now, as you're looking at them, I'm pretty sure you notice the difference between these horses and our domestic ones. One, they have shorter legs and a stockier build. They also have an erect mane. They're missing the forelock. That's a piece of mane that drapes over the forehead of our domestic horses. Now, to receive this first animal in 1902, and to date, we've had over 50 Mongolian wild horse foals. process upper meadow that we're in right here. It's just an extended area where we do allow our horses to play, frolic, and run around. So here at the Bronx Zoo, we do offer them plenty of room and allow them to do just what they want to do. Again, our Mongolian wild horses, and again, all this upper area is theirs, and yes, folks, they use every bit of it. From the up to the upper, from the back to the front, this is all theirs for the Mongolian wild horses. As we slowly proceed up this hill, we're now on the lookout for one vulnerable and endangered species. And believe me when I tell you, it is very large. We're talking about the Gaur, the world's largest wild cattle. Males can weigh over 2,000 pounds as much as a small car. They stand 6 feet tall and are 10 feet long. And with their large size and impressive horns, a male gaur can fight off just about anything, folks, and that includes a tiger. But what threatens these huge animals is the look of their Asian habitats and diseases that they do catch from other domestic cattle. Now, this time of the day, they normally go to the far right of the meadow, so if you look up to the far right, back by the fence over there they go, the gaur, the world's largest wild cattle, and they are huge. Recently, we've added two females and a male from San Diego. They arrived by special truck as we're trying to increase our herd, and we have been successful. We now have new gallows, and you see some of the calves over there. Now, only 4 zoos in America carry this species, and of course, the Bronx Zoo is one of them. Now, if you can, folks, try to get a good look at those horns. If they're coming in, those were females. If they're slightly pointing up, those were our males. They have the gallows, the largest wild cattle. And believe me when I tell you, not too many other animals bother them. They're as powerful as big. The gaur, the world's largest wild cattle. These are my favorite, the gaur. And I'm seeing some of the calves over there. They're getting bigger and bigger day by day. And after we test our scientific and observation skills, you might be hearing a noise coming from the concrete jungle rather than Asia one. You know, it's easy to forget that the culture right here is used to reduce the noise of that city traffic because we do want to keep our animals calm. I'm going to ask everyone to please remain seated as we're about to round this corner, because we are now on the lookout for a tiger. Excellent camera flips in the difficult spot. The secret that even professional researchers are finding them. Which is why you're only going to see one of them at the exhibit at a time. And once we round this corner, we're now on the lookout for Anakin. Now, Anakin is our 8-year-old male Siberian tiger. Now, the two types of species that we show here at the Bronx Zoo, the Malayan and the Siberian, also known as the Amur, the Siberian are the larger of the two. So look for that beautiful orange color, those black stripes. Now, folks, I think I just found him. It might be a little hard to see. I believe he's asleep. If you look up to the top right, he just put his head up. Look up to the top right, behind those bushes. So look up. There he is. Now, once we pass these trees and come around, look back to the left. Hopefully, we get a better view. Hopefully, he'll stand up and walk around. But again, look up to the top right, he's right behind the bush. Now, tigers hunt a variety of animals, but they prefer wild pigs and medium-sized deer. Now, typically, a tiger will gorge itself on a fresh kill, eating as much as 40 pounds of meat at one time. There he goes, folks. Now, that's the equivalent of you and I eating 160 hamburgers in one sitting. And after a meal of that size, a tiger not eating it for about several days. He's sleeping right now, or resting. And if you do want to get a closer look at our tigers, you can visit our tiger mount right here at the Bronx Zoo. Again, that was Anakin, our 10-year-old male Siberian tiger. Now, come up this morning, look up, you get a peek at the gaur. Closer look at the gaur. Now, between 4 and 4:30 p.m., those large wild cattle are going to come right down on this hill, very close to the train, and it's a sight to behold. You can really appreciate their great size. And as we're about to come down this small hill, we're now on the lookout for the deer that we didn't see in the first meadow. Some more of our black buck antelope. Now, once we pass this large tree, those big, beautiful, honey-colored deer, and down to the far right are the Barasinga deer. Now, they get their name from the look of the male deer antlers. Barasinga means 12 times in Hindi, and that just means the males have 12 to 14 points on those antlers. And look at the baby with the mother. Here's the baby, the Barasinga deer. Now, the next animal blends in with the muddy area it calls home. If you see, it looks like a pig with upper tusks that are up through the top of his snout and cut backwards towards his eyes, you found a pig. in order to attract other females. Now, a grand color slay blended very well with the exhibit, as we're passing by a small bamboo forest. Look between the bamboo, and he's lying right between the hay and on the large rock. That's Linus. There he is. Notice those tusks. Now, the second pin we have Kenneth. Now, he's going to make it hard, folks, because he's right below us. That's Kenneth. He's asleep. But that's okay, because if you had a hard time seeing those animals, believe you will not have a hard time seeing our next ones, because we're about to see the world's largest land mammals. And, of course, we'll talk about our Asian elephants, Happy and Patty. And they're going to be right below us, folks. Happy's going to be right below us. Look down to the bottom right. Now, that large tree that you see by the Chaparral Pool, that's an elephant-sized back scratcher. Now, African and Asian elephants are iconic animals worldwide, but they're struggling in the wild. Now, the first thing that you notice about this lovely lady is her size. Anyways, in the elevated track, the river still rushes along, providing a habitat for turtles, ducks, fish, and migrating birds. Look down right below us, these are Canada geese. Now, the WCS knows how important it is to protect the Bronx River corridor and its greenway. So, notice the Bronx River here in New York or the Irrawaddy River in Asia. Rivers and streams are vital resources for wildlife everywhere. Now, this next rocky terrain is the perfect environment for our next two species of animals and both the well-adapted climbing rocks and mountain slopes. We're talking about our Barkaw and our Himalayan tar. If you look down on the ground and on that large center rock and start looking over to the right, our male Barkaws are the ones with those long, two hooks, which on the males can grow as long as 5 feet. Tensions on the female, and the males also sport those cool beards under their chin. Now, these animals are able to jump 6 feet straight in the air, folks, and that's without a running start. 6 feet straight up, and our Barkaws are known to climb these trees just to reach the fresh leaves. They are excellent climbers and leapers. Now, we also have the Himalayan tar. They have a darker, shaggier coat, and want to go directly back up their head. They're going to be on the Barkaw and Himalayan tar. Now, the train is about to slow up, folks, and that's because we're approaching a large tree coming up on the right that looks like the shape of a V. Now, behind that tree is a smaller tree, and down to the bottom right, laying on a special branch, is Linus, our red panda. So as we come around, I don't want you to miss this. Our second animal on the monorail named Linus. Remember earlier, we had the Barbarossa named Linus. Now look down to the bottom right, there's Linus, our red panda. Now people have been fascinated by the color of that fur. Now in Nepal, they call Hun Ho, which roughly translated means firefox. And the Chinese word for red panda translates small bear cat. Now today, folks, we know that the red panda is not related to the giant panda at all. They're more related to skunks, weasels, and raccoons, and they both eat bamboo. And if you'd like to see some more of our red pandas, you can visit our Himalayan highlands, which is a short walk from the monorail. And you'll also be able to see our snow leopards, Asia's other big cats. And as we round this bend, our journey is almost at an end. And you've heard from some of our animal experts, and you tried out some of your own science skills while on this ride. So we hope that you've been inspired by what you've heard, see today, and remember. In addition to 95 parks here in New York City, the Bronx Zoo, the New York Aquarium, the Central Park Zoo, the Queens Zoo, and the Prospect Park Zoo, the WCS has scientists in the field at more than 300 sites and in over 60 countries. Now, conflicts between you and wildlife are becoming a more common concern.
back for you.
I made it.
Yo, bro. Yo.
What? Look how big he is. Look at him.
Yeah, but their stomach, remember that they
harbor it. They're losing their fur. They're getting another fur.
That's when
they're getting the summer fur down.
That's when they start eating to be able to get fat for the winter. Estamos dando la lo pelo. De cero, mira, o sea, va a como con el negro. Niña,
pero que mira.
That one's like a watermelon. That got